Club. Hello everybody. Hope you all had a very good lunch. So I'm going to be talking about open source in neuroimaging. So let's kick off with hopefully quite a bit of a disclaimer and a warning. Firstly, I am not a medical professional, so please don't take my talk as medical advice. Research anything for yourself before looking at any of the areas I'm going to talk about. And I'm not entirely sure that some of us are actually being legal in some areas. I know there are actually restrictions on some of the items I'm going to talk about. So, quick introduction. So I'm a senior engineer and I'm also an open source consultant at CodeThink. We specialise in projects based in Manchester. I have also been a Linux kernel contributor. So I have some experience in open source. So I'm going to talk a little bit about why I chose this area and a few of the caveats. So brains, I mean, what does about 1.2 kilograms of stuff in your head actually do? It's not just there for cannibals. I'll try and keep the jokes down a bit. And I found as interesting that open hardware and software is actually showing us that you can actually find out how the brain works. And this is stuff that used to be just medical research, and it's now getting to the point where a hobbyist can do it. And I will end up with actually talking a bit about a project that CodeThink was involved in producing such a device. So the caveats, you've seen the previous warning. The talk is not going to be able to go totally in depth into some of the topics. And in some places, I've probably just taken the top Google example. So there are other things out there. So, brief definition. So, neuroimaging is a direct or indirect set of techniques for looking at either the structure, the function, or the pharmacology of the brain. This is all sort of under encephalography, which means basically the same thing, and is generally of interest to such fields as medical, where often they need to diagnose some problem, the psychologists who actually like to try and work out how your brain is working, and I think probably the topic that most people would be really interested in is the person-machine interface. So while I was researching this, I've seen a few actual products available where people have been trying to actually get your brain to control some device. So I believe that there is actually a Star Wars toy where you try to use the Force to influence your computer. While I was looking at this, I also came across the 10% of your brain myth. I don't know if anybody hears that occasionally, that you only use 10% of your brain. Well, actually, no, because you actually use 12% of your brain to actually just run the functions that you require to stay living. So, basically, it's about 10% is active at any one time. So, I'm going to talk a little bit about the structure, but not much, because the structure is difficult to actually view, especially if you haven't got a lot of money. Generally, non-invasive scan techniques are quite expensive. I mean, who around here has a functional magnetoresonance imaging machine around? No. If so, you're earning too much money. So with like techniques such as the fMRI, they're using standard MRI techniques that you use to look at the structure of the body and looking at how the brain is using blood, because as you are thinking about things, it requires energy to actually run, and therefore you can see the blood flow. There's also other things like PET, which is positron emission tomography. Again, you're probably not going to see this in the hospital. It's very much a injection of a radioactive marker, usually a glucose, I believe, and you scan for the usage of the glucose, which causes a small radioactive emission. And then you also, x-rays will also give you a bit of information. That was just a notable mention. If you've got a dead brain around, you could have a look at it by an invasive biopsy, but that isn't going to be very easy to find. People don't leave brains lying about. Again, also, reasonably, people prefer it if you're not invasive when you're doing this sort of stuff, because this sort of stuff can hurt. However, interestingly, because most of the studies that are done are generally university or other sort of funded, there is quite a lot of open data available. So when I was looking at Wikipedia, which is where I got quite a lot of some of my information from, there's about 3,000 scans listed. In fact, there's now databases of scans because there's that much available. So, for one example, there's an open fMRI site that is collecting, I think, it's about 3,000 subjects so far, and it publishes the data under a Creative Commons license. And then, so you get that data, I believe it's all anonymized. People obviously don't want their data being distributed with easily traceable information such as their names. So, and there are tools out there to analyze that data. So there's a, for instance, there's a tool called FreeSurfer, which is designed to process this. Now, I'm not going to go into actually the tooling here, just to say that this sort of thing is standardized. There are standards for the data processing. Unfortunately, whilst the data is open, some of the stuff, rest of the processing stuff isn't. I know MATLAB is a very popular tool for data analysis, and that isn't open. So, so a little bit more about the structure, and this is what we're generally interested in if we're going to be measuring something we can actually measure for ourselves. You probably know that the brain is made up of neurons. This is the sort of thing that gets talked about with neural networks. So these are the hardware, what you call the hardware building blocks of the brain. They're not very big, about micrometer in size. That's about 80 billion of them in your brain. So there are quite a lot of them. And there are generally four or five different types. So you have your motor neurons, which are outputting data to your muscles. You've got the standard processing neurons that are in there doing the actual data movement. And then you've got sort of sensor neurons that are taking data that's coming from things like your eyes and actually in bring them into the brain. So what we can measure is how they communicate. So generally, one neuron is doing one small bit of processing, and then they're linked to other neurons by synapses. So I've got a picture of a basic neuron there. I've forgotten actually the labeling on it. Oops. But the basic communication methods are the chemical, so those are the neurotransmitters that you would hear about, such as serotonin. I'm not going to talk too much about those because generally trying to alter them is either a medical professional's job or illegal? Yeah, I would say actually some of the other things, if you are trying to do brain training, that is also can be quite dangerous. But what we can measure is the electrical effects of the neural communication, and these charges, when actually in the neurons, are about a tenth to a volt. So the first technique we're going to talk about is EEG, which is an electroencephalography. These are not easy to say. So this is measuring that electrical activity when it gets to the edge of the brain, i.e. your scalp. Generally, this is done by attaching some electrodes. And you can then measure a voltage against a reference point. So you probably put some electrodes around your head and stick on a reference electrode. And by the time the neural activity has permeated through the brain, that's about 10 to 100 microvolts. So it's not beyond the means of modern hardware to measure this. We're talking, brains are not that fast, so we're looking at a frequency of about between 1 to 100 hertz. The other thing to say is that the charge produced by a single neuron by the time it gets to the scalp is too small to measure, so you're actually measuring a group which could be 10 to 50,000 neurons that will. The advantage of EEG is quite simple. So most people here with some electronic skill could put together a device that would measure that sort of voltage. There's plenty of medical people who can do it. So it doesn't require any invasive tracers or actual sticking things into people. And the good thing for, say, the hospital usage is that there's no preconditions that would limit the treatment. So, for instance, you can't go into an MRI machine if you've got any metal in your body, whereas that's not a problem for things like EEG. So, I've taken a quick example here. I haven't tried this myself, but this is actually open hardware and open software. So this is openbci.com. They do have a store where you can actually buy this stuff. And they ran a Kickstarter back in 2013 to produce this. That is a newer version. So they're not only doing EEG, they're also adding things like EMG, so looking at the muscles, and EKG, which is looking at the heart. So you can actually bring multiple measurements in to a system. The example shown here is what they call the Ultra Cortex Mark IV. So just to say, you can actually buy this pre-assembled from their shop, or you can buy some of the bits. And as it's open hardware and software, you could actually, if you have a 3D printer, print some of the parts for this. Then you could have the control board, the sampling board made yourself, so pretty much DIY. And you're looking probably at about a few hundred dollars investment to get something like that. So that device can take about 16 channels as standard, and you could actually upgrade it. I believe this has been used in a number of projects. Unfortunately, I don't have the reference to one I was really interested in, where an artist who is struggling with muscular problems has actually used this plus some eye tracking software to continue producing art. This is an example of somebody using open systems to actually produce a useful thing. So I'll talk quickly a little bit about hardware. So this is sort of Arduino. The original one was actually based on our Arduino, and this new one is similar sort of technology. It's a PIC32 with some SD card storage, and you can add things like Bluetooth, so you can actually store quite a bit of data if you say want to wander around in one of these. You might get some funny looks. So, moving on, this is an example of the software. So you have, on the left, is a trace of all the electrodes that are picking up electrical activity. Top right is actually a frequency analysis of that data, and then there's a plot of where it's coming from on the head. So you can actually correlate the waves to roughly where it's coming from. So you could do experiments like looking at a box of kittens or a nice fluffy duck and go, that bit of the brain is being stimulated by cuteness, and then you could have a look at, say, some of the politicians around going, So, in software like this, there's other software available, and generally they have interchangeable data. So these are basically what you could call brain waves. So this is, I can't actually remember what activity this is monitoring, but there's about seven different types of brain wave. So they're named after Greek letters, and for example, the alpha, which is in about 8 to 15 hertz range, that's associated with like relaxation. And there's other things, so the delta, which is under 4 hertz and can be quite a large wave, is often found in sleep. I've actually tried this. I'm quite a fan of downloading stuff off the internet and shoving it on slides. I was showing the EEG stuff because it is actually quite popular, and with the advent of open hardware, which I'm going to talk a quick little bit about these four projects, is becoming actually accessible to a number of people. So, the Open EEG project that has a GNU with some electrodes on it, that's quite an early one and was designed for a few channels connected to a PC serial port. So it's not going to be hugely fast, but it was enough to get just some basic information. I believe that Olimex actually were selling, or maybe still are selling, a very similar solution to that. So the Brainstorms project, that's not hardware as such, that's more a software suite for processing data from a number of sources. So it will support MRI, EEG data, and actually bring it all together and producing a way of analyzing that data. So you can try and match the signal positions to, say, a structural scan. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. So the last one, the PAC EEG, which is a bit newer than these, and that is a little bit interesting. It's an Arduino Duo shield, so you can actually stack four of these up and have 32 channels, because that is an 8-channel board. So that's quite new. I find that quite interesting in another aspect is that it's based around a chip by Texas Instruments that is pretty much a EEG on a chip. So it has 8 input channels, differential input to the reference, and has a 24-bit low noise analog to digital converter in it, which can go up to about 16 samples. And that's actually, I think they're available for about $25 a chip in small quantity. That's a few example projects for EEG. So I'm now going to move on to a little bit of a less of a hobbyist scale method, which is MEG. So this is a magneto-encephalon. I did pick a really difficult to pronounce subject. Magnetoencephalography. So this is magnetic sensing of the brain's activity. So if you think about it, if you've got an electrical current flowing, you also get a small amount of magnetic field, which you can hopefully detect. So the average field is in the 10 femtotesla range, which is quite small, so you need very accurate detectors. But the advantage for, say, analysts of the brain is that it's actually slightly more accurate. So in EEG, you have currents radiating out, but they're actually not only interfering with each other, but the brain is not a perfect conductor, and certainly your scalp and skull are not a perfect conductor. So you can actually get interference. Then again, if you're using MEG, if you're using EEG, you're probably not looking for really detailed analysis. You might be just looking to see if the person's having a seizure or whether they actually still have a brain operating. So MEG has similar response times, but it's a bit more accurate. Now, the issue is with this is that background noise is in the 1,000 femtotesla. So you can already see we have a problem. If we want to actually detect any activity, we have background noise as a problem, which means that if you're actually going to build a machine with current techniques, you need to actually put it in an expensive shielded room, which is actually really part of the rather large cost currently of an MEG system. I'm talking about MEG because this is part of the project I'm involved in, and we'll look at that in the next slide. The other slight issue is not all neural activity actually produces a detectable magnetic field. Some neurons actually run against each other, which means that the fields they produce actually fairly well cancel each other out. So, as I say, it's not currently cheap. So, I'm going to talk a little bit about, I'm going to talk quite a lot about, because this is something that I'm involved in, is the MEG project that I've been involved in and is currently actually going through FDA approval. So, why did we do this? Well, when we came to this, the latest technology is, and what we call state of the art, is from the late 1970s. This meant it was difficult to repair. I mean, who around here has a spare spark station? I didn't. So our goals were not only to improve and make it repairable, but also we'd like to use as much open source technology as possible, and we're hoping that at least some of this work can be open sourced. So, why we chose open source? Well, this actually started off because I knew somebody at the university and they were doing a research project. They obviously wanted to be able to do MEG. Their system was basically crumbling around. This is now actually moved on to a commercial company called York Instruments. So we wanted to be able to make a project that had a good longevity. We're not talking about like an Android phone that you throw away every couple of years. You're going to be spending, I think it was like about $500K on one of these machines. You can't just throw it away. And as I said, we were having problems. So the original manufacturer had gone out of business, and we would like to avoid similar problems. If manufacturer goes out of business, you no longer actually use a machine when it goes wrong. The other thing, these are often used in research projects, so it's a very good feature to be able to peer review the system. We also had a hard problem to produce, so we needed to actually produce something that worked. Our original plan was to actually make something that would fit the original energy systems. That has actually evolved now into producing something better. We also were worried about security. So obviously people don't want their data being leaked or have like the default password as password. So people need to be able to actually review that. So I didn't put this quote on the slide. From our customer, they said, "It is also a matter of confidence. With very few professionals in this area are confident with a product that's not based on a peer-reviewed platform." Again, to pick on Microsoft, technicians and clinicians simply don't trust Windows to be reliable, quick, or usable when controlling the industrial hardware. So quick overview of what we put together. So we had a scanner that we needed to capture data from. So we have down here the MEG. We built a system to actually capture the data from there. That is then transported over a network. We have multiple nodes, so we have a data aggregator installed. We have control. An operator, and then anybody else who's involved in the experiment can look at the data. We needed to be able to store the data, we needed real-time viewing so that if anything was going wrong, we could deal with that. Part of this as a research project is we also needed to be able to add arbitrary experiments. So, for instance, you might want to show the subject some images on the screen and support the response. So you need a reasonably reliable way of synchronizing that with the rest of the data. So we have experiments, and those could be disjoint. So you have your experiment is not actually easy to connect to the same bit as the scanner. So I said earlier we had to actually magnetically shield, so you can't really shove a monitor in the same room as something that actually will detect the monitor. A quick run through the hardware. Unfortunately, I can't get a picture of this. Obviously, our customer is very busy dealing with the FDA and trying to get it actually approved for actual clinical use. But one of the actual not open improvements we made was that the original sensors for the magnetic field needed to be cooled by liquid helium. Now, liquid helium is not a nice substance to have around, and it's not actually contained by anything other than like expensive metal containers. It's also quite difficult to get hold of. So the design we're using is actually still cooled, but it's actually self-cooled by refrigeration unit. So the size of the problem, and I mentioned this was started some time ago, I believe our initial design was done in about 2008-2009, is that we're looking at about 300 channels of data recording, because that's how many magnetic sensors we had were putting around somebody's head. We wanted to get 24 bit data out of the system. The original system, I think, was only like 14 bit. And for some reason, even though I've already said that the brain tends to operate in about the 100 hertz maximum region. We have 118 kilohertz as the max data rate. So that was producing quite a lot of data. We tended to split it into 8 channels per, actually it's 16 channels per node. So that's about 3,400 kilobytes a second if you were operating the system at a full rate. Generally, you don't actually need to sample at that sort of rate. A few kilohertz is usually useful enough for data analysis. If you're looking at that rate, we're looking at about 250 megabytes a second. And back in 2009, we were thinking that was a lot of data. Now, that's not as much. Your average commodity PC, as you can see, not commodity, but something you could just buy off the shelf, is going to handle that sort of data. Now, I'll talk a little bit about the actual capturing nodes. So we chose an ARM-based system with an FPGA. We're designing it for like 16 channels per node. So we were going to have a number of nodes. We didn't want them to be expensive. We couldn't cool them in position because that would have added extra noise to the system. ARM is an excellent choice for low power. So we chose an SoC that was low power and had a reasonable networking system. And then the FPGA, we went for a low-end lattice in the end, but that was there because we're looking at trying to do something that is real-time in the way that Linux really can't actually manage, or any processor really can manage. We'll talk a little bit about that next. Software first. And we went for Debian as a base, because it supported the ARM and x86, and probably anything else we were dealing with. We already had a requirement to be maintainable, and Debian is both stable and maintained. There was like build routes and things like that available at the time. We hadn't got to optimal really. But we didn't want to have something that had had to be manually maintained. We were happy that we could just do an apt-get update and that would be fine. It was also reasonably customizable for our needs. All the ARM nodes we tended to netboot and had a minimum Debian install for those because we couldn't have hard disks. Well, they produced magnetic noise we didn't have enough flash to put the entire system into each unit. Also a big plus, we had at least two Debian developers on hand. When we looked at the data recording, and there's a format called HDF5 that was already well used in other systems. So that was well understood, and everybody who had similar machines already knew how to process that. And that was designed for large time data sets. So it had directory inbuilt, so it was actually easily searchable. The second slide on software is not surprising that we chose Qt and OpenGL for the front end work. It works and is actually cross platform. Whilst we are trying to do something that's open source, there's still people using closed source systems such as Windows. So it's interoperable and reduces the time of having to port it to other systems. What I was quite interested in is that a lot of this sort of field in the actual analysis of the data is now moving to using Python. So we were also quite happy that there were lots of Python packages available. So things like NumPy for dealing with numeric processing. I think Arrow is the date library. And then you also have HPy, which is a package that allows you to deal with the HDF5 files. We moved to U-Book. So this was our first vendor problem. When we started, one of our vendors was all, we have all this great stuff. they went out of business. So before we'd actually got a product to market, we already had a problem with longevity. So we moved the software to U-Boot. So all the nodes, instead of using the proprietary bootloader, we moved into U-Boot. Worked very nicely. It took about a week to do, and then that was that problem solved. I'm not going to talk about the custom control software. There's a bit of stuff to do the actual control experiment. So this is the sort of thing we're doing with Qt. Again, this is like the EEG display we're showing activity, except now we have a lot more sensors. So this system is, you can't probably see, we have 320 active channels, 32 reference channels, and then you probably can't actually see that there are also 16 external digital inputs that are being recorded from the whatever experiment is being done here. So, so a quick note on the FPGA side of things. So we chose the FPGA basically because we're having to deal with real-time sampling. We actually finally settled on about 3 nanoseconds between all the nodes in the system. So obviously this isn't something you can really do in a microcontroller. But again, we actually could use open source. So whilst the PCIe DMA were closed source that we got from the vendor, we could use the Wishbone bus specification to write our software to. We could use the OpenSPI implementation. What was very weird is that once we got the PCIe vendor core, the manual said, well, if you want to do something with this, go and have a look at the example project. So when I look at the example project, it's like, well, they've taken the PCIe to Wishbone example of open course. It's like, why on earth are we paying them money for this? So, we've got a quick diagram. So it shows that the FPGA is doing a lot of the work. There's an external ADC. Then we have external changeable front ends for doing the various measurements. So you either have the MEG front end for measuring data from sensors, or you could have your experiment front ends that were taking the stimulus data from your experiment and capturing those for your reference. So, we obviously using Linux, we have the kernel. That was very easy. Both the SoC and the vendor kernels, when we were supplied, were actually quite close to upstream, which was pretty important to us in the maintainability. So we started, I think it was at 3.16, and we've upgraded to 4.9. So tracking mainline has actually been fairly easy to do. We haven't had to do much of that update. I mean, the only custom code we've had to write was something that detected our PCIe device and split it up into the various bits that the system required, and do that mostly via a sysadmin interface. I'm not going to talk too much about that. Safe to say, it was actually fairly easy. So we're coming towards the end of the talk. So from an actual project review, we found Debian to be a fairly good base. We've upgraded from Debian 6 to Debian 9. So that's been quite painless in System D. The open FPGA tools, now that's a problem we've not been able to solve, and people are still working on it. So there's no open tool chain or open IP calls, which makes reproducible builds, which we'd like to do, very difficult, because we basically provide all our software in Debian packages and use them still. The PCIe core was possibly the worst bit to actually try and debug, because it's a black box, you can't really see into it, and we had some problems. But it turned out that we spent this money on a license for PCIe, and we'd given the tools license, didn't they get back to be licensed? So it would work for 4 hours, and then the appeal time would kick in. It's like, why is it stopped after 4 hours? That one was quite a difficult one. I haven't said anything about PCB design. Projects like KeyCAD are coming on and making life very much easier for people who want to do open hardware. At the moment, we're still using closed solutions because that's what everybody in involved in the project is actually used to. When it was started, that wouldn't have been an issue. That we wouldn't have been able to do that. The improvement in these software areas has actually been really good for that. I say at the start of the project, this seemed awfully large. Technology in the last 5 to 7 years has improved quite a lot. We'd hope that the FPGA tools will improve as we give feedback to the manufacturers to say, look, Windows tools are not good for people who actually want to do certain things. So I'm going to bring the talk to end. I've overrun very slightly. So the thing I've taken away from this, the open source community is helping the field improve. We have people doing their, being able to do their own experiments. We've been able to produce new hardware. Hopefully, once this, once my project I'm involved in, that will enable people to actually move forward, and hopefully it will spur on some competition. And there's still areas that are unfortunately closed. I mean, we'd love it if you could actually get down to the point of having something like an MEG scanner being affordable to, well, not an average person, but maybe an average doctor. I mean, we'd love to see these sort of technologies come down in price, and I'm hoping that as more people look at this, that the issues that are around these things can actually be crowdsourced. So that's the end. Thank you very much all for attending. I hope I haven't bored you too much.